If somebody doesn't like it, well, it's still great. It's still great. So he sat there during the meeting. He squirmed a little bit, had a very serious look on his face. I'm not real concerned, folk, with consequences. I'm really not concerned. And like I said, if he doesn't like me, well, too bad. And again, I don't want to sound cold or hard, but I believe that God has given us a message to give to the world. And if people like it, great. If they don't, then you just better get out of the way. That's it, Nellie. So, and as I was telling one person, I think it was Dumasani, the man I was staying with, I said, you know, if that man never invites me to his little church in the area of England where it is, and I won't say where it is, but if I was never to go there and speak there, you know what? You know how much I care about that? Right there. That's how much I care. And again, folk, you know, Bill, you sound pretty hard. No, it's just that consequences and results are really not up to us. Our job is to share what God has impressed us to share in the light of the truths that God has given to us as a people. And the consequences and the response and, you know, whether people, you know, smile and are, you know, get a warm fuzzy out of what's said, well, great if that happens. But if it doesn't, and somebody wants to stick you underneath the fifth rib, well, then so be it. So be it. So, anyway, with that in mind, let's kneel for prayer. Dear Father in heaven, thank you for your great love to us today. Thank you for this Sabbath. Thank you for being here with us. And thank you for all the blessings that you have poured out upon us, safety, meeting all of our needs, taking care of us day by day, helping us in our battle with temptation. Thank you for helping us to know that you're with us always, even to the end of the world. We just pray for the Holy Spirit to join us today, to galvanize us, to empower us to go to the ends of the earth, that others may know of you, of your goodness, of your power, and of your soon return. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Some of you with that introduction may think, oh boy, this is probably going to be a tough one this morning. Well, you know, actually, this message this morning is one of the most precious that I know of in all the Bible. It's absolutely awesome. Go ahead, sweetie. This is the final, of course, in Ezekiel. This is the last sermon in the book of Ezekiel. We're going to be looking at the end of Ezekiel 47 today and Ezekiel chapter 48. Ezekiel 47, 13, 14, and 21, the Bible says, "Thus saith the Lord God, this shall be the border whereby ye shall inherit the land according to the 12 tribes of Israel. Joseph shall have two portions, ye shall inherit it, one as well as another, concerning the which I lifted up mine hand to give it unto your fathers. This land shall fall unto you for inheritance. So shall ye divide this land unto you according to the tribes of Israel. So at the end of Ezekiel chapter 47, it's pretty obvious what's taking place here. Ezekiel is saying, after the captivity, when you come back to the land of Canaan, there will be a division of the land. Well, that's one application of these verses. There also, folk, is another application, because there will come a time when God's people will go to heaven and will inherit heavenly Canaan. They will inherit the land of promise. So there is a double application to this morning. Next slide. And of course, as you get into Ezekiel chapter 48, you have the division of the land. And it's all based on, the borders of the land are all based on the various tribes of Jacob. Now, of course, we do see, I have underlined different tribes. You do see here two that were not the immediate sons of Jacob. Ephraim and Manasseh were actually the sons of what man? Joseph. That's right. So here's Joseph's double portion when the land was divided. Ephraim would get a portion, Manasseh would get a portion. And then, of course, you have all the other sons of Jacob. Reuben, of course, being the firstborn, and Judah the fourth, and so on and so on. What fascinates me about these various people that are mentioned here, these were the people that God was going to divide the land. They were going to be the heads of those various pieces of property. Do you remember anything about this man, folk? How about this guy? Do you remember anything about these men? Dan, Asher, Naphtali? All five of these men were involved in one of the most heinous crimes recorded in all of Scripture. What was that? They sold their brother, Blanca, that's right. They sold their brother into slavery, which was a living death. How did these men end up in these most exalted positions as heads of the tribes of Israel? You know, when you look at this family from which all of these men came, the word we use today is called dysfunctional. Have you heard that? Miss P, you've heard that word, haven't you? Dysfunctional. It's a very common word that's used today when we talk about families that are in disarray. These men, next slide, sweetie. Along with these men, came from one of the most dysfunctional families this world has ever seen. Do you realize that? And yet they are going to be at the head when the land was divided. Reuben was the head of one tribe and over an area of land. And Simeon was over another, and Judah was over another. And Naphtali, and Issachar, and Zebulun, and Gad, and Dan, and Asher, and Benjamin. From a family completely dysfunctional. I want you to think for a minute, and I don't think I put this on any of the slides. These men grew up These men grew up seated at a table, living in a family where there wasn't one wife, there wasn't two wives, there wasn't three wives, there were four wives. Four wives, 12 children. One of those four women was loved, wasn't she? What was her name? Rachel. That's right. Who said Rachel? Good job. Good job. What is your name? What is it?
Cheyenne.
I think I've seen Cheyenne before. Hi, Cheyenne. Rachel was the only wife that was loved. She was the only one that Jacob acknowledged as his wife. So you have, well, who were the other three wives? Who were the other three wives of Jacob? Can somebody tell me? Give me one. Leah was another wife, so that's Rachel and Leah. Cheyenne, tell me another one. Bilhah, very good, sweetie. Bilhah was one of the servant wives. She was the servant of Rachel. And when Rachel couldn't have children, which was the curse of curses in the East, Rachel said in her absolute extremity, "Jacob, I can't bear. Give me children from my servant." And so Bilhah became a surrogate mother, not a wife. It wasn't a wife. It was a surrogate mother for a baby for Rachel. Okay, so that's three, but Jacob had one more. Who was the fourth one? Bilhah, Rachel the beloved, Leah the tender-eyed. Who was the fourth one? Somebody tell me, starts with a Z, ends with Pa, Zilpah. That's right, Zilpah. Those were the four. Do you know what, folk? Can you imagine what it must have been like sitting at their table? Jacob comes in from the field, he's hungry, and he sits down to eat, and Leah sits down across the table at him. And do you know how many things Jacob would say to Leah? Jacob despised her. Jacob hated Leah. Do you know the effect that had on the sons of Leah? Here's your mom. And your mother is being treated with disdain and hatred and silence by your father. Do you think there weren't hurt feelings in Leah's heart? And where did Leah pass that hurt and that pain and that anger? Who did she pass it on to? She passed it on to her children. You know, we see Simeon, when a 17-year-old half-brother comes to their encampment after walking 65 miles. And what do we hear Simeon say? He says, "There's that brother of ours that thinks his dreams are going to make him our king. Let's kill him. Let's kill him and throw him into a pit and then tell our dad that some animal killed him." Well, Simeon was pretty close because he was behaving like an animal, wasn't he? But that's all Simeon knew, folk. He knew anger in that incredibly dysfunctional family. You know what? I want you to notice a verse. This epitomized the family in which these young men grew up. Epitomized it. Genesis chapter 49, verse 31. What a passage of Scripture. What a passage of Scripture. Listen to what the Bible says. Jacob is about to die, folks. He's about to die. I mean, he's within 5 minutes of death. This is what he said. He's given a benediction to all his boys. Verse 31. Okay, he tells them in verse 30, this is where I want you to bury me. Verse 31, he says, there they buried Abraham and Sarah, his wife. There they buried Isaac and Rebekah. Who? Who was Rebekah? What does the Bible say? Help me. I cleaned my ears this morning. His wife. That's right, Cheyenne. Jacob said, Abraham was buried there, and Sarah was there, and Sarah's his wife. And Isaac is buried there, and Rebekah's there too. And Rebekah was Isaac's wife. Now, what does the rest of the verse say? And there I buried who? I buried Leah. Now, there's something missing there, folks, in that verse. What is left out of that verse that you would have thought Jacob would have said? His wife or my wife. Jacob didn't say that, did he? And the Bible says in verse 33, when Jacob had made an end of commanding his sons, he gathered up his feet into the bed and yielded up the ghost and was gathered to his people. Folk, Jacob was dying. He had a couple of minutes left. He says, bury me there. Abraham and Sarah, his wife, are buried there. Isaac and Rebekah, his wife, are buried there. And I buried Leah there. And that tells you the smoldering anger that lived in Jacob's heart for Leah to the end of his life. He could never say, she was my wife. Now, folk, you would think, let's see, Joseph at this time was 56 years old. 56 years old. Jacob had been around Leah till Leah died 30 years? We know Rachel died first. So Jacob was around Leah for 30 years. He still could not call her his wife. Folk, there was animosity, there was hatred, there was anger that existed in that home. And this man imbibed it. And all of these children saw it. They all saw it. It tore that home to shambles, among other things. And these people are going to end up, not only were they at the head of the tribes that took over the land of Canaan, these people's names are going to be enshrined on the gates of the New Jerusalem. Are you kidding? Does God condone hatred and anger and viciousness? Does he? No. No. Next slide. So here would be the division of the land. Of course, with the Jordan River right here running along the eastern side of Israel, there were three tribes that inherited land east of the Jordan because they were herdsmen predominantly. Manasseh took this area. Manasseh also had some of that. So they got half here and half here. Gad got some of this land here, got this land. Reuben, and then the rest of the brothers divided up the land right here. Amazingly, the 12 tribes inherited the promised land. That happened in the days of Joshua, after the Babylonian captivity, and the heavenly promised land will be inherited by spiritual Israelites, by most of them as well. Folks, this is shocking. This is shocking. How can it be that a family that was rife with hatred and anger? Now, let's take another swing at this family of utter dysfunction. You have Jacob. You have two sister wives who are jockeying. They're jockeying for the bedroom to see who can be with Jacob. What is that creating in the minds of those children as they're growing up watching this? Well, there's jealousy. But folk, where is there a healthy concept of what it means to have a normal home? Was there anything healthy in having, first off, two wives, but then two more? And how about the sordid story? When Rachel was so desperate to have a child. Reuben was out in the field and he saw some mandrakes that supposedly at that time had medicinal qualities that would help a woman have children, right? And so Reuben comes in from the field and he's carrying these mandrakes. And he tells his mother, "Mom, I've got these mandrakes." And guess who overhears the situation and sees them and says, "Give me those mandrakes. Maybe I could have a child." Who saw that? Rachel. Rachel. And so Rachel enters into a bargain. She bargains for the mandrakes. And what did she do? She sold a night with her husband for some mandrakes. What do you call that when you sell? What do you call that, folks? That's called prostitution. Is it possible that there could be a clear misunderstanding among all of these young men as they watch four women jockeying for one man? Do you think any of those young men had a right concept of a man and a woman relationship? That's impossible. And so it bears out. What do you have? Reuben decides as he gets older that Bilhah, one of Jacob's servant wives, is attractive. So what does Reuben do? The firstborn son, what does he do? He sleeps with his dad's wife. That's called incest. Now, before we're too hard on Reuben was dead wrong, but before we're too hard on him, what had Reuben seen growing up, folks? He saw the same thing. He saw complete dysfunction. He saw just a mess. That's what he saw. Why couldn't he do the same? He did. And how about Judah? Remember the story of Judah? Judah went in and was with a woman who was dressed like a prostitute. Later found out it was his daughter-in-law, but nevertheless, he didn't know that ahead of time. All of this, folk, was in the dysfunctional family of Jacob. Murder. Simeon and Levi were murderers, folk. Multiple murderers by the time they reached 20. They were a couple of years older than Tabitha. And they were multiple murderers? That's right. Not with Joseph, with the men of Shechem in Genesis 34. Multiple murderers? There was gross immorality in that home. There was what were... The young men were such cowards that they would sell their brother to slavery. What a delightful home. Wouldn't you like to grow up in the home of Jacob? You wouldn't, Brian. Man. So why did God choose this family? He could have chosen a mom, dad, boy, girl, that's it. He could have done that. Why did he choose the most dysfunctional home that you can dream of? I don't think God could have done any better with the family of Jacob if he had dreamed. Now let me see. What would be the worst home in which I could make it the heads of the tribes of people that are going to be on the gates of the New Jerusalem? What is the worst family I could think of? Jacob was perfect for that, wasn't he? It was a perfect family for complete dysfunction. Next slide. How the names of the 12 tribes will be emblazoned over the gates to the New Jerusalem is amazing. It's amazing, folk, that dysfunctional group or family would have any connection to holiness, to purity, to glory. Defies reality. That's just not reality, folks. So why? Again, and I ask you, why did God choose such a family? Ezekiel 48:31-35, the gates of the city shall be after the names of the tribes of Israel. There they are. Three gates northward, one gate of Reuben. One gate of Reuben. The immoral one. The licentious one. One gate of Judah. Sleeping with a whore. One gate of Levi, the bloody murderer. And then on the east side, one gate for Joseph, one for Benjamin, one for Dan. And then on the south side, there's that other mass murderer. There's one of the cowards, Issachar. There's another coward called Zebulun. On the west side, one gate for Gad. We'll learn about Gad. One gate for Asher. One gate for Naphtali. And the name of the city from that day shall be, the Lord is there. The Lord is there. You know how that translates into Hebrew? Lord, with all capitals, is Yahweh. And the Lord is there, it's Yahweh Shema. Yahweh Shema. The Lord is there. I'm so thankful, folk, that the Lord was there. I'm so thankful He was there in the family of Jacob. Because if He hadn't have been, it would have been a tragedy. Next slide. What will the gates say on them, folk? We notice one of the gates had Reuben's name on it. Jacob said in Genesis 49:4, this was Reuben, unstable as water. Thou shalt not excel, because thou wentest up to thy father's bed, then defilest thou it. He went up to my couch. Of course, we know in Genesis 35:22, it says, it came to pass when Israel dwelt in that land that Reuben went and lay with Bilhah, his father's concubine, and Israel heard it. So what will it say? What will it say above Reuben's gate, folk? Will it say, Reuben the immoral? Reuben the licentious? Is that what it will say? Is that fair? You say, but the New Jerusalem, the gates are going to have to say something good. You tell me something good you can say about Reuben. Next slide. So what does Reuben teach us? How is it that Reuben could be right up there on the gates of the New Jerusalem? His name will be in fire on one of those gates. Well, you know what? Reuben's not the only one that has ever struggled with immorality. And Reuben learned his lessons. God's not going to take impurity into the promised land. God is too pure to do that. But what he will take to the promised land is people who have learned the lesson of disobedience and have learned to submit their heart and their mind to the will of God. Folk, Reuben will be in the kingdom because he learned that lesson. Did it hurt? Yeah, it hurt. Did he have to learn to surrender his carnal heart? Yes, he had to learn that lesson. But he did. And you know what? There will be many men and many women who will go through the gate of Reuben because they, like him, will have learned the lesson. There will be possibly this man who will go through the gate marked Reuben. His name was David. Samson, who is in the hall of faith in Hebrews 11. Solomon. All of these mighty men who struggled with immorality could very well go through the gate of Reuben, couldn't they? Because they learned the same lessons that he did. A host of others who have fallen into moral impurity find hope through Reuben's gate because they, like him, have fallen, have repented, and found power in Christ to overcome. Reuben's gate awaits them. Reuben's gate beckons people, folk, and says, there is hope for you. There is hope for you. Next slide. I think Judges 5, verse 15 opens a window into Reuben's character that brought him the victory for which he longed. In the famous story of the battle with Jabin, the king of Canaan, we read this. The princes of Issachar were with Deborah, even Issachar and Barak. He was sent on foot into the valley. The divisions of Reuben, there were great thoughts. Now, in my translation through the concordance, it says there were great searchings of heart. Folk, Reuben searched his heart. Reuben repented of his sin. And Reuben's prayer was the prayer of the psalmist David, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." There is hope for the Reubenites who want God to search their heart, for God to try their thoughts, and if there is any wicked way, then lead us in the way everlasting. There is abundant hope today for Reuben if we are willing to allow God with the flashlight of truth to search our heart and to allow him to say, "That's got to go. That's got to go." And by the grace of God, Reuben can still overcome today. Next slide. Simeon and Levi. Jacob said, "Simeon and Levi are brethren. Instruments of cruelty are in their habitations. In their anger they slew a man." They didn't just slew a man, they slew a town. They slew an entire town. In Genesis 34, it says, "It came to pass on the third day when they were sore, two of the sons of Jacob, Simeon and Levi, Dinah's brethren, took each man his sword, came upon the city boldly, and slew all the males." These guys, folk, they saw it, they felt it, they grew up with that anger, and when they had a chance, they carried it into action. And they killed a town. You say, well, you know, Dinah was taken advantage of by Shechem. So there's some justification. Folk, when did two wrongs make right? Never. Never. Never has, never will. Wrong is wrong, and it needs to be confessed and by the grace of God forsaken. Period. Two wrongs don't make a right. That's what they lived with. That's what they grew up with. They were angry. They were angry men. Next slide. So what's going to be over Simeon and Levi's gate? Is it going to say cruel, murderer? There's hope. Some of us harbor things that have happened to us from others, and we harbor anger, and it comes out, and we yell, and we use names to brand people and to be hateful to people. folks, Simeon and Levi took their anger and used it to kill. Now, I know that sometimes we like to think that, you know, the Bible says, be angry and sin not. And so if somebody upsets us, somebody gets us mad, we think it's okay to yell and scream and call somebody names. Folks, that's not what the Bible's talking about when it says, be angry and don't sin. That's not what the Bible means. It means if the glory of God is being abused as it was in the temple in John 2 or in Matthew 21 when Jesus said, take this out of here. Don't make my Father's house a house of merchandise. When God's glory is being trampled in the dust, when a minister is getting up and espousing that the papacy is our friend, that the Pope is a Christian, then it is that you can stand up and say, you are in apostasy, and you can be mad. You can show righteous indignation. But folk, don't play that card and say, well, you know, so-and-so got me mad the other day, and so I tore that person's character to shreds, and I brought up what's been happening for the last 20 years, but I was justified because the person said something to me that I didn't like. No, you can't play that card. That's not what the Bible means, folk. Not what the Bible means. Simeon and Levi's name will be emblazed on the New Jerusalem. Not because they tried to justify rudeness and unkindness and cruelty, but because of the suffering that they saw in their father, because of the pain that they went through to see what it did to their family and to their own children as they were coming up, Simeon and Levi repented bitterly for what they had done. Bitterly repented, folk. And they became changed. And over their gate, there is hope for somebody who has harbored anger or cruelty and just used out-and-out meanness to deal with other people. There's hope. There's hope. Because Simeon and Levi's names are on the gates of the New Jerusalem. This is the kind of repentance the Apostle Paul talks about. He says, you sorrowed after a godly sort. What carefulness it wrought in you. What clearing of yourselves. What indignation. What fear. What vehement desire. What zeal. What revenge. In all things ye have approved yourselves to be clear in this matter. Next slide. There's hope for the angry and the cruel. The children of Levi repented of their wickedness. They showed their faithfulness at Mount Sinai, if you remember the story. When everybody was dancing around the calf, when Moses said, who's on the Lord's side? Stand here. The children of Levi stood there. There was a change, folks. There was a change. These two men give hope for those who have allowed corrosive cruelty and anger to ruin their lives to be restored. The gate for Simeon and Levi is for them. It's for them. Next slide. I think this one's my favorite. Issachar, Genesis 49, 14 and 15. We read about Issachar that he was a strong ass, or we might use in our modern day terminology, he was a strong donkey. Couching down between two burdens, He saw that rest was good and the land that it was pleasant, and bowed his shoulder to bear and became a servant unto tribute. Issachar was not flashy. Issachar was not flamboyant. Issachar was not some fantastic celebrity and some great man that stood at the pinnacle of God's people. That was not Issachar. Issachar was a hard worker. Issachar was a burden bearer. Issachar served others. Issachar, folk, just simply gets the job done. That's Issachar. We read almost nothing of him in the Bible. In the days of David, we do know in 1 Chronicles, I believe it's chapter 13, it was the men of Issachar that came forward to support David when it was not pleasant to do so. When there was still division over Saul and David, Issachar came forward, the children of Issachar. Issachar also understood the signs of the times, the Bible tells us. Not flashy, not flamboyant. He just gets the job done. And those who, like Issachar, just simply go through life doing a good job that brings glory to God, that does not have flashing lights around them, but simply does their duty. The gate marked Issachar is for them. Next slide. Another one I find fascinating is Gad. You say, who? I've heard of Joseph, and I've heard of Reuben, and I've heard of Judah, and I've heard of Dan, and I've heard of Simeon and Levi, but Gad? Yeah? Genesis 49:19. Gad, a troop shall overcome him, but he shall overcome at the last. We know this about Gad in Genesis 39 through 11. When Leah saw that she had left bearing, she took Zilpah, her maid, gave her to Jacob to wife. And Zilpah, Leah's maid, bare Jacob a son. And Leah said, a troop cometh. And she called his name Gad. Did you just read what that says? Did you see what that says right there? Think about for a minute what this must have been like. You're a servant, okay? You do whatever the boss says. You take orders from the boss. She's a slave. She's her maid. Leah says, I'm thirsty. Zilpah says, I'll go get you water. Leah says, I'm cold. Zilpah grabs a blanket. Leah says, I need something for my feet. I need to cut my toenails. Zilpah grabs the cutters. Zilpah was right there every single time. But now it's changed. She's still a servant. She will always be Leah's servant. But now she's also her master's husband's wife. What? Who does she take orders from now? Is there anybody that she gives orders to? You talk about confusion, folks. Zilpah has to balance absolute respect for Leah, even more respect for Jacob, But she's also now Jacob's wife. So she's a slave, and she's a wife of her master. And she's got to be careful how she plays it, because if she gets to where Jacob likes her too much, Leah could get mad. Do you realize, folk, the eggshells that Zilpah had to walk on? I better not upset Leah, but I'm still Jacob's wife. Do I give orders to anybody? Folk, this woman had to be the consummate politician. She had to be to survive. Zilpah was a survivor. She was a survivor. And guess who saw how Mama survived the situation she was in? Who watched it all? Her son did. And Gad became a survivor too. The Bible says that because Gad was a survivor, which is always often the case, when somebody learns to survive in situations, their survival depends upon it. In trying to acquiesce, in trying to give in so that you are safe, sometimes you go too far. And when you go too far, you sacrifice principle. That's what Gad did. And the Bible says a troop shall overcome him because of the way he would acquiesce, the way he would try to blend in the crowd. We don't know what he did other than unite with the brothers to sell Joseph. But there were things that overcame Gad because he tried to run with the crowd. A troop, not a single soldier, but a troop shall overcome him. But there's hope for the survivors, because Jacob said he will overcome at the last. Gad learned and understood and realized that in being a survivor, you've also got to be firm. You've got to take a stand, even if people don't like it. And Gad learned that. And those who will go through the gate marked Gad will have learned the balance of survival and firmness. We just went through that. Zilpah, folk, had to be so slick to survive the intrigues of being slave wife, all at once. That wasn't easy. She knew how to maneuver through situations. Next slide. In Ezekiel, all the tribes are there. All the tribes are there. But over the course of time, two tribes went missing. Revelation 7, verses 4 through 8, gives us the final roll call of the tribes of Jacob. And there's two of them left out. See if you can find them. The Bible says the tribe of Judah had 12,000. These are the 144,000. Reuben, 12,000. Gad, 12,000. Asher, 12,000. Naphtali, 12,000. Manasseh, 12,000. Simeon, 12,000. Levi, 12,000. Issachar, 12,000. Zebulun, 12,000. Joseph, 12,000. Benjamin, 12,000. Two are missing. Dan, Ephraim. Dan and Ephraim aren't there. Ephraim, it's very possible. There were some faithful in Ephraim. Joshua was an Ephraimite. They will be saved under the tribe of Manasseh, his brother. But why did Ephraim not make it in the final roll call? When you look at all the rest of these folks, you see the amazing grace of God that changed these men. How could Dan and Ephraim not be there? Next slide. It's interesting. This is the only sin that God can't forgive. Dan never was wrong. It's kind of like the saying today, the only time I made a mistake is when I thought I had made a mistake. That was Dan, folk. Dan never did anything wrong. We find the story in Judges 18, 24 to 26, when Dan had stolen from a man named Micah. And the man named Micah had caught up with the children of Dan. Micah said, "Why did you steal from me? I only treated you well." And the children of Dan, when they were confronted, said, "Hold your peace, let not your voice be heard, lest angry fellows run upon thee, and thou lose thy life with the lives of thy household." And the children of Dan went their way, and when Micah saw that they were too strong for him, he turned and went back to his house. Dan could not take his sin being pointed out, folks. Dan had his way. Dan won't make it because Dan never did wrong. Next slide. Ephraim. Ephraim was too good for everybody else. Ephraim was the son of Joseph. Everything he needed was provided by a servant who was standing at his hand at all times. Ephraim felt that he was a big shot. Ephraim felt that he could tell everybody else what to do, and he didn't need anybody to tell him what to do. That was Ephraim. In the story of Jephthah in Judges chapter 12, 1 to 6, we see this very characteristic. Jephthah, in having people cross over the Jordan River in a battle they were having against the children of Ammon, Jephthah had told the people as they crossed the river to go fight, he said, "I want you to repeat a word," and the word was this, "Shibboleth." Well, when the people of Ephraim came to the river to say it, because they had never been willing to stoop down to learn this simple word of Shibboleth, they said the word Sibboleth. And because they said Sibboleth, the Ephraimites were slaughtered. This was characteristic of Ephraim, folks. Ephraim could not stoop. Ephraim would not humble himself to anybody because he was the boss. And in the eyes of heaven, God can't save somebody who doesn't need his saving power. Next slide. Next slide. I'm so thankful today that the names over the gates of the New Jerusalem are not marked Joseph, Daniel, Jesus, Enoch, They're not marked that way. If they were, I know myself, I would look at those men, and of course, Christ Himself, as exemplary, holy men. But I'm thankful today that over those gates are Reuben, Simeon, Levi, Judah, Gad, Dan, Asher, and all the rest. It tells us still today what Christ can do for us. Let's kneel for prayer. Father in heaven, thank you so much this morning that you took a dysfunctional family and you poured your infinite graces, and by their willingness to repent and by your amazing grace, you changed them and you transformed them so that their names will be emblazed on those heavenly gates. Thank you, Father, so much for the courage that brings to each one of us today, that your grace can help us overcome, just as it did the children and the family of Jacob. In Jesus' name, amen.